Cooper, your host on Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. The program is subtitled Voice Myths. Voice Myths. People think they have a certain type of problem in the medical community. My colleagues in medicine and academia are also of the view they are well-versed in what they're telling patients, and I find all too often it's misinformation, misstatement, and misleading. I'm sorry to tell you that. I wrote books about that, and the latest book I have is called Curing Hopeless Voice Problems, called The Strangled Voice Spasmodic Dysphonia, medically termed. We have two young ladies in studio with me, and I brought them together for the very simple reason. One has spasmodic dysphonia, there's no question about it, and the other young lady is given a possibility of having spasmodic dysphonia by a well-qualified neurologist. I differ with the diagnosis, and I'm saying publicly and I'm saying privately to her that she doesn't have spasmodic dysphonia. But if she does, they would Botox her for life when she doesn't have spasmodic dysphonia. The other young lady is an attorney, and she does have spasmodic dysphonia, and she has had Botox. It hasn't done the job for her to her satisfaction, and she's come to see me from outside the LA area. So we're going to talk with both of them because I think it's a very interesting contrast. One has spasmodic dysphonia, what I'm telling her to do, and the other doesn't have spasmodic dysphonia and what I'm telling her to do. The prognosis I find for both of them is excellent, but one with spasmodic dysphonia is going to take a while. The other can do it quickly, but we're into voice myths. So let's get to the two young ladies. Let's start with, your name is?
Sarah.
Sarah. Why did you come to see me? Could you briefly tell me what happened?
I came to see you because I wanted to discuss with you the possibility that I might have spasmodic dysphonia. I had been told by a gastroenterologist who was working me up for reflux that I might possibly have spasmodic dysphonia.
I don't know if you know it, so I will tell you. It's in my book, Curing Hopeless Voices, The Strangled Voice, Spasmodic Dysphonia. And the book is on my website. It's free. You download it if you want. There's no charge. I give away my secrets. In 1992, Merck sponsored the study that acid reflux was causing bad and raspy voices. I don't find that true clinically, but people are then given acid reflux basically for long periods of time, if not life. I'm not sure of the long-term treatment, but patient after patient tells me when they have a bad raspy voice, and especially when they have spasmodic dysphonia, that acid reflux is a basic cause of their problem. That's my take clinically. It's not true from my clinical experience. Study was done in 1992. And patients across the country who have bad raspy voices are told it's acid reflux. Not so. It's a myth, in my opinion. Now, you were told acid reflux is the cause.
It was suggested to me by an ENT that that might be the cause of my problem.
The one you're using, the voice problem you have?
Yes.
Okay. It's hard to hear you.
My voice feels very weak, and it's difficult for me to project volume.
How long does it last? How much can you talk a day?
I speak maybe an hour a day at most.
Does your neck get fatigued?
Yes.
What did I tell you to do?
You told me to raise the pitch of my voice.
Mm-hmm. And how did I tell you to do that? Do you recall? I saw you once.
Yes, you did. Well, you did a maneuver with your hand on my solar plexus, where you jiggled that. And you also had me hum the first bar of Happy Birthday.
Could you do that now? Where do you feel that humming?
Across the bridge of my nose and the lower part of my face.
Where do you feel it when you're talking the way you normally talk?
When I normally talk, I feel it in the back of my lower throat.
Mm-hmm. Could you point to that area? Thank you. That's voice suicide. You're misusing your voice. Bad, raspy voices, 99% of the time, clinically, is in the lower throat. And what I try to get you to do is change the placement of the voice to the face. Could you hum the first part of Happy Birthday again? Perfectly normal voice. And it's very simple, isn't it?
Yes.
No drugs, no surgery. You have a voice image. You don't want to use this voice, the one up there. I want you to hum the first part of Happy Birthday, and then after you hum, I want you to say, Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper. Can you try that?
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
But you go off the hum. I want you to hum it. Happy Birthday, Sarah.
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
It's not in the face. I want you to talk to me when you say Happy Birthday as though I'm a little hard of hearing. A little hard of hearing. Could you do that for me?
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
No, I want you to make it louder. I'm a little hard of hearing, Sarah.
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
Okay. Now, how loud is that to you?
It's a bit loud.
How loud?
I can't quantify it in decibels. I don't know.
You're talking in the lowest throat now. Hum the first bar of Happy Birthday. You feel it up there. Now, I want you to say it to me like I'm deaf, like I'm deaf. Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
No, you're down here. I want you to talk on the hum.
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
Still not doing it. I want it louder.
Happy Birthday, Mort Cooper.
You're using it from the lower throat. That's why if you do the lower throat voice, you're going to fatigue. It's going to hurt you.
Yes.
And that's what you tell me, right?
Right.
Right. You have to talk in the face. Now, here's how we change it. One.
One.
You drop it off. I want the one at the same level. One.
One.
That's it. Two.
Two.
That's your voice. Three.
Three.
You don't like that voice. You've been telling me that. You don't like it.
It sounds unfamiliar.
It's unfamiliar. I'll buy that. Do you like it?
I don't know.
Try it again. One.
One.
Two.
Two.
Three.
Three.
That's how you get out of this. You practice on the numbers. It's not a voice that you're familiar with. How long have you used the voice that you're talking with?
It's been a problem for 6 months. I don't know how long I've been using my voice. It
down
hasn't
here.
Sounded this way for
say,
6 months.
One.
One.
Say it louder.
One.
Two.
Two.
Does it sound like a little girl to you? This is honest time, Sarah.
It sounds unfamiliar to me.
How would you characterize it? It's a little girl. It's not you. It's not a mature voice.
It sounds like an artificial voice.
It is. Because you're not familiar with it. Do that again. One.
One.
And count to ten. One. Two.
One. Two.
You're going off it. One.
One. Two. Three.
You're going to have to practice that till you get ready. Okay, let's move on to the young lady. Do you hear the change? What is your name?
Nancy.
Nancy. Do you hear the change in voice?
I do.
How loud do you hear her? Is she loud?
Not to me.
No, not to me. Not to the audience, but to herself. You hear yourself through the bones of your head 3/1000ths of a second faster internally than you do from your mouth to your ears through air conduction. So you can't tell. You hear her.
I do.
So do I. She can't hear herself. That's not a put down. That's a reality. You have spasmodic dysphonia.
I do.
Do you know her name?
Sarah.
Sarah doesn't have spasmodic dysphonia. And if she had acid reflux, I don't believe it would make any difference, because people who come to me tell me they have acid reflux. Very few do, but I say it doesn't make a difference. It's the way they're using your voice. Were you told you have acid reflux?
No.
Okay. You were treated with Botox?
Yes.
By a very prominent ear, nose, and throat doctor?
A voice specialist.
Right. Well-intentioned, humane, compassionate.
Absolutely.
Lovely bedside manner.
Absolutely.
Did the Botox shots help you?
For limited periods of time, but it never totally took away the shakiness of the voice, the breakup, the so-called strangulation sound.
You feel it in the lower throat?
Yes.
You clear your throat? Because you're squeezing from the lower throat. All spasmodic dysphonia is from the lower throat. The medical people and I agree. It's all from the lower throat. They say you have a neurological problem they can't find. It's incurable. They tell you that?
Yes, they did.
Mm-hmm. I don't believe you have a neurological problem that is causing your problem. That's my paradigm. I differ with them. They told you there are no cures of your problem.
That's correct, at least at the present time.
Mm-hmm. You heard a DVD of 2 hours in my office. These patients are cured, diagnosed by the creme de la creme ear, nose, and throat doctors in the country with SD.
Yes, I did. Yes.
How can I cure a neurological problem? You're a lawyer. When all medicine, all academia say there is no cure, how can I do that?
That's why I've come to see you, because I read about the success rate that you've had with people diagnosed with spasmodic dysphonia. And what also appealed to me was the non-invasive aspect of your procedures.
I do it all naturally. How can I cure a neurological problem, a dystonia, that's what they say you have, a disease, a genetic problem, a basal ganglia impairment in the brain, a chemical imbalance in the brain? How can I cure that condition, a medical condition, by just telling you what to do? What did I tell you to do with your voice?
Well, there are two aspects. You indicated to me that my breathing, for lack of a better term, is bass backwards. In other words, that there are certain techniques where when you take a breath, your stomach should move out. And then as you speak on the breath, you should be pulling in. And I do just the reverse.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially, I'm trying to speak without appropriate breath support.
SD patients specialize in talking without air. Did you know that?
No, I did not.
That's why they can't talk. You have to learn to use midsection breath control. And the young lady with you, your name is?
Sarah.
Doesn't have to do that. All she has to do is put her voice up in the face and talk a little louder, but she doesn't like that, because that is a voice that's unfamiliar to her, and she doesn't want to put her voice out there. What will people say? Am I right about that, Sarah? What will people say if you use the voice I'm telling you to use?
I'm not conscious that that's my thought, but perhaps it is. I don't know.
You're talking this way, right. The voice image shatters patients. They will not change, although mechanically what I'm telling you is right on the button. I wrote about that in 1971 peer review. I've been peer reviewed about curing bowed vocal cords, unilateral cord paralysis, peer reviewed medical journals, academic journals, and so forth. But I'm a voice in the wilderness, and I'm ignored, which is okay with me.
Dr. Cooper, you also indicated to me that as someone with spasmodic dysphonia, I not only need to relearn, in a sense, appropriate breath support, but that I too need to raise the pitch of my voice so that I too need to speak through the facial area.